you will have the whole world. Own in Hawaii, and you will have the whole world. Remember hearing this from a sales pitch. Perhaps every other week in the mail, like me, you get these offers for different timeshare, very cheap vacation offers. And having lived in Arizona, where it was just one flight and not a pilgrimage to get out there to Hawaii, my family decided that we would take up one of those offers to go to Hawaii. After all, it was about the same price as a staycation at the Motel 6 down the road, so we thought that we would go. Of course, they say they have these no-pressure sales presentations where they show you the benefits of ownership here in Hawaii. And they say that if you own in Hawaii, you own the world because of their complicated point system whereby you can get 2 weeks in the middle of nowhere at Hotel 6 for the 1 week that you paid in Hawaii. And so here it was, this invitation to escape, this invitation to be a part and to come out of. And boy, there are some slick presentations that try to convince us that this is what we are working for. This is the sum of our experience of the other 51 weeks of life, the toil that gets us to escape. Travel in any world airport, and right as soon as you leave the airplane on the jetway, there's these beautiful pictures of all of these resorts and these refuges. And then you get out of the airport and you drive 25 minutes through the third world before arriving to the gate to get to the resort, right? Of course, in the Christian church, in its history, we have sought some manner of escape from the world, some healthy space and distance from which to work on the things of our faith that are most true and most worthy. These, of course, are places like monasteries and the monastic orders and lives that were built up. There's a tradition of the desert fathers removing themselves from daily life in order to commune with God. Of course, one of the priests in the diocese said that they went ahead and named their child Mary Grace so that they wouldn't have to change it when she moved into the convent. So we have all sorts of traditions in Christianity where to escape or to be set apart has been held up as a good thing. Of course, on the other extreme, we have that several stories in our own country of cults forming, right? This idea that we would be set apart has become a little bit too extreme. So John's gospel that we're reading from, we're coming to the very end of Jesus' time with his disciples. He's preparing to be betrayed as they make the journey across the Kidron Valley to the Garden of Gethsemane. And here he is kind of saying this prayer with them, this pastoral or priestly prayer, it is sometimes called. And John's community that would have been hearing this a couple of generations later might have found some desire for this type of escape. They, after all, were at odds with not just one aspect of the world, but a couple of different aspects. On the one hand, they were more and more drawing distinctions between the practicing Jews of their community, and so they were less and less involved in the weekly pattern of life in the synagogue. And so, on the other hand, they were finding themselves in empirical dominion that was increasingly hostile to Jewish life and to Christian life. And so they were coming under more and more attack, not being allowed to live out their faith in daily life, but rather from two sides struggling with this tension. So perhaps it would be that their escape from this life, their drawing inward out of the world, would have been very natural. And here it is towards the end of John's gospel, Jesus' time with his disciple, that he's encouraging something a little bit differently. It's from this verse, or perhaps from other Christian preachers, that you've heard the phrase that we are in, but not of, the world. We are in, but not of, the world. That would have been the title of one of Billy Graham's messages as he went on his crusades, right? In and not of the world. It's a good message. It is. I want to hear something a little bit different in the scripture, though, that I think might change how it is that we see our lives as followers of Jesus Christ. So with John's community at odds, the temptation was to escape. And perhaps that is true about our lives as well, that part of what it is to live in the day-to-day of our life is to know suffering, to be vulnerable to harm, to find ourselves with a bit of waffling security. For most of us here, that's probably not security of shelter, of food, but it quickly does become, on the hierarchy of needs, we find ourselves in the struggle, as we said. Here it is, though, that we find that the reversal that perhaps can change our orientation of what this is. So rather than thinking of ourselves as in the world but not of the world, I want us to think of it differently. In the world but not of the world starts with us being in the world. Kind of starts with this recognition that, well, here we are. We're in this world and we have to live with the pressures and the struggles of society, the struggles of our own lives. And perhaps if we can't afford to escape to images of retreats like Hawaii and whatnot, we seek for escape that's closer to home via the bottle or via a prescription drug overdose that plagues our communities, right? And so perhaps the invitation is, instead of making in the world be our starting place, we're calling and being called as a church to reverse that, to flip that, to have our starting place to be the starting place of Scripture, which is that we are first created and made in the image of God. We are first blessed as a part of creation from our own God, from the divine will, who just incredibly and beautifully creates the creation. And that our starting place then is not in the world but not of the world, but perhaps we are of a divine image sent into the world, sanctified for the world. So Jesus has this image where he says, wish I had it written down in my other bulletin, not for the Episcopal one. It says, I'm not asking you to take them out of the world. I am not asking you to take them out of the world. How much has the Christian church over its time been so overly concerned with escaping and being taken out of this world, typically at our mortal death, with the promise of salvation in paradise that we just can't deal with right here and right now? This invitation then, if we hear it from Jesus speaking to his disciples, is to be regularly and always in communion with our God, in touch with the source of our life, resonating with that which is love, and then being sent into the world to be set apart within it, rather than being set apart from it. And in that way, then, the church can become this vehicle by which we are nourished in community, sent into the world to bear witness to this love, sent into the world to find the needs of those who are not met, and help them find food and security of shelter. Help them to find their way into the basics of life that we have so long enjoyed. Perhaps it is then from this place that we might think about our relationship with the world as something that we don't try to continually escape, but rather something that we embrace, something that we don't give ourselves and lose ourselves into, but that we stand in as followers and as members of the body of Christ. What might it look like then to live in this world as followers of Christ, to be in this world not varied by the changes and chances of life as our own experience, as our own identity, but rather more firmly as a follower of Christ, able to companion and be with those who go through their lives in this way? This invitation is to, in a sense, confront and be with the evils of the world in a way that speaks love. In a way that speaks love. And that's not easy. And so I could try to give you a bunch of answers about how to do that in a sermon that would last 5 minutes longer. But that's not what the point of the sermon is. The point is that we have to continue practicing together, finding the times to learn together how it is that we live in this way, how it is that we walk and witness to love in the midst of a world full of evil, how it is that we proclaim a gospel message of good news as Christ calls us to, even as we confront the darkness in our own lives and the journeys through the valley of the shadow of death. You know, it's been said that as Christians think about in their proximity to Easter, which this is the last Sunday in our Easter season this year, it can be said that life is lived as though it were the three-day pattern of Jesus' death and resurrection. It feels like most of life, the 2 days, is lived harrowing hell. And we want to escape to that beautiful resurrection on Sunday morning. Perhaps the invitation there is to remember that the resurrection to which we seek, to which we are called, again, is not one about escaping from this world, but precisely about redeeming the woundedness and sin of this world together in Christ. So that Sunday morning, we don't jump to get out of here, to escape the world by coming to church, but rather, in coming to church, we become sanctified to go and be in the world, set apart for its witness to love. In closing, just to share this sense is a quote by Thomas Traeger, who is a pastor and theologian, and his invitation is to let this be the seed that flourishes into Pentecost for you. That we would all have a sense of Christ's presence that allows us to be sent to live vitally and faithfully in the world, sanctified within it, fully engaged with its needs and wounds, and energized by the truth, the saving truth of God's incarnate and resurrected word. So my prayer for us, brothers and sisters, as we prepare to receive the gift of the Holy Spirit, to remember the birth of the church and the vitality of the apostolic ministry, we are sent precisely into this world to become peacemakers, to be dwellers in the midst of pain, woundedness, anger, trial, as witnesses of hope and peacefulness that is lasting and beyond even our own understanding. Thanks be to God.